So once again, I'm Tina Kamp, and it's my pleasure to introduce this final panel of the conference, and it's been an amazing conference, and I'd like to thank all of the folks who made this possible, including the staff of, including and particularly the staff of both BCRW as well as the Heyman Center for the Humanities, who have been, at the Stony Brook Humanities Institute, all of whom have been really incredible in helping us pull off this many hydrid event. So I want to begin this panel by returning to the image that we used for the poster. It's an image that I've written about in the book that I just finished this summer called Listening to Images. And it's a photo that was that actually was very striking to me when I saw it, and was striking to my fellow organizers as well. But it's a photo that was taken by a photographer and filmmaker named Janet Mendelsohn. And it was taken in Birmingham and first published in 1969 in ULTA, the University of Birmingham Review, while she was studying on a Fulbright Fellowship at the Center for Cultural Studies. The image was shot on Varna Road, on one of the main streets in the area of Balsall Heath in Birmingham. And the photo is a perfect example of an image that is really beckoning for a cultural studies reading. For what appears on the surface as a reality is always, as we've talked about over the course of this conversation, in need of deeper analysis. At the time, Balsall Heath was a major site of settlement for post-World War II West Indian migrants to Birmingham. And Balsall Heath and Varna Road were also a notorious hub of crime and of sex trade as well. And it was the site of complex conflicts, collaborations, collusions between those communities, the Black and Asian communities that settled in that area, and the police. So one of the reasons I thought that this would be an image that would resonate is that it resonates in a lot of different directions, not in the expected directions that we want to imagine in terms of the relationship between police and minority communities, but in all sorts of different directions. And I start with this contextualization of this gorgeous image to me, and Janet Mendelsohn's work has actually been reclaimed in Birmingham by the university. They've recovered an entire archive of her photographs that she took in those early years, and they're actually going to be displayed at an exhibition in this coming spring. So I wanted to sort of put a shout out to that her images tell the story of Birmingham, tell the story of what cultural studies was about in that particular moment in time, and this is not a random shot. So I just wanted to actually use that to come back to the actual title of the core of the event, as well as the title of this particular panel, right? The idea behind the panel was to, or is to, reanimate the links between Hall's keen diagnoses of state violence and structures of dominance targeting racialized communities and our present and continuing struggles with them today. The events he analyzed in his early collaboration on Policing the Crises and later in his investigation of the murder of Stephen Lawrence resonate in haunting ways with recent events in Ferguson, Staten Island, Baltimore, and South Charleston. I pose two open and again very broad questions to our panelists as a frame for their remarks. What tools and resources does Hall's work offer for understanding our current social order and contemporary movements against disposability of racialized subjects? It was one of the same questions I posed the other panel that I organized. The second question was, what strategies have you developed in your research, teaching, and activism, and how might we constructively draw on Hall's prescient analyses to play them forward into the now of the present? Again, we have a group of speakers who are going to give us some outstanding takes on these questions and these issues. The three members of the panel that we have are going to be speaking in the order in which they're seated. Ben Carrington is Associate Professor of Sociology at the University of Texas, Austin. Carla F.C. Holloway is James B. Duke Professor of English, Law, and Women's Studies at Duke University. And Barner Hesse is Associate Professor of African American Studies, Political Science, and Sociology at Northwestern University. So I'm going to present to you first Ben Carrington.
Good afternoon. I'd like to thank Tina and the organizers for putting on such a splendid conference over the past day and a half, over 2 days, and also to Connolly, who's helped to organize this and do the administration. I'd very much like to thank everyone involved and the other organizers as well for putting on this event. I'd like to do something slightly different. When I looked at the star-studded panel of speakers and realized that I was on the last panel, I thought that rather than taking a particular concept of halls or a particular part of policing a crisis and working it through in typical academic fashion, that I would try to do something different. And part of that is in relation to what Tina said in relation to listening to images and the work that we really get from Hall's influence within visual sociology about reading photographs and images. So that's some of the impetus behind my talk today. And I also do think it's interesting that we're in Harlem right now. When you look at the phrase that is in the police in the crisis and the concerns of the British media when they say that must Harlem come to Handsworth, this concern that Harlem is going to be imported, that the mugging phenomena into the UK. So the fact that we're now cycled back to this actual space of Harlem, I think is a kind of an interesting thing that we might want to talk about in the Q&A in terms of the space where we're actually located right now. And I'd like to dedicate this talk to Catherine. Living the crisis through 10 moments. This is a story told in 10 moments. Moment one. He is 5 years old. He is happy. Technically, he's not five just yet. He is 4 3/4, as he likes to tell people. But in his mind, he is five. Then he thinks he'll be taken seriously. Five is when you start primary school and get to wear a uniform. He hopes it will have some red in it. He likes the color red. It's his favorite color. It is the summer of 1977, June the 7th. The boy is full of innocence. He is told that, along with the nations of the Commonwealth, today all of Britain is celebrating the Queen's Silver Jubilee. He doesn't know what the Commonwealth is, but it seems like a good thing. He imagines every street in the world is having a street party at this very moment. He's not quite sure what Britain is either, but he is told that he is British, and it sounds important, so he is happy that he is British. British like everyone else on the street where his grandparents live. And the Queen, whoever she is, she looks pretty with her pink hat and her pink dress. She looks just like the stamps. He is a bit confused when he is told that today is not the Queen's birthday, but the anniversary of her becoming Queen. He thinks it's funny that you can celebrate becoming yourself. The boy wears his favorite red and white striped shirt. He has a British flag, and a flag has red in it, so he likes the flag. Everyone has a flag. He waves it as hard as he can. Everyone sings songs he doesn't quite understand about something called Britannia. His football team will be Liverpool because they also wear red. He doesn't like blue, else he would have to have been a Chelsea supporter, or even worse, an Everton supporter. Thus, he is doubly lucky that he likes red. He hopes the Queen has a silver jubilee every year. He gets to stand in front of the photo, although he ends up standing next to the two twins, who he doesn't much like. But otherwise, he is happy on his summer's day, standing in the middle of the street. He belongs. He is British, along with everyone else. The ground beneath him is firm. He is settled, and he gets to keep his flag with the red in it. Moment two. He clutches his mother's hand. For the first time, the boy sees fear in his mother's eyes. It is not the crowd or the noise that initially worries him. It is the realization that his mother may not be able to protect him. He thinks of himself as a brave boy. He wants to protect his mother from whatever it is that is causing her to look so concerned. But he is scared too. The chanting grows louder. The boy and his mother quickly move into a nearby building off of Lewisham High Street and run up the stairs. There, others are hiding too, strangers with pensive expressions. The boy looks out of the window and sees signs that say, "Clear the muggers off the streets" and "Keep Britain white." The boy doesn't understand the words or their significance, but he senses that somehow he is connected to their anger. As the white crowd approaches, the boy grips his mother's hand harder. He moves away from the window so that he can't be seen. The crowd, many male, but with a few women, are being escorted by the police. They eventually move past and down the street. If they are bad, he wonders, why are the police protecting them? Apart from the uniforms, the police and the marchers look the same to him. For months and years after, in fact, into his adulthood, the boy will have a recurring nightmare that he's being chased by a mob through narrow streets as he hides in buildings. The men with hate in their eyes are holding the same flag he was waving earlier in the summer. He notices that they are singing the same song. "Rule Britannia, Britannia rules the waves. We shall never, never, never shall be slaves." Were they angry at the Queen? Were these the muggers they wanted to get rid of? Who were the muggers? Why was his mother so scared? At home later that evening, a pale man appears on the TV news. He is called Martin Webster, the organizer of the march. He is from the National Front. The man barks, "We believe that the multiracial society is wrong, is evil, and we want to destroy it." The boy goes to his bedroom. He collects his Jubilee flag and slowly places it in the bin. The ground beneath him is no longer solid. Something in his world has ruptured. Moment three. He is 9 years old. The news is full of pictures that disturb him. He sees cars on fire, young black men throwing bottles and bricks at the police. He sees police officers bleeding. Windows are smashed. Politicians announce that unemployment and racism are no excuses for the actions of the youths, but it's not clear to him why this is happening or what is happening or why. He sees image after image of young black men being chased, being arrested, fighting with the police. They have afros like his. Some have dreadlocks. They look angry and threatening. Brixton is burning, they say. White figures discuss the problems. He hears terms like West Indian culture, Rastafarianism, assimilation, the breakdown of law and order, sus laws, and muggers. It appears that black people are the problem. Margaret Thatcher says that the government will not tolerate such lawlessness by criminal gangs. He doesn't understand why the black youths are doing what they are doing. He fears going to school the next day in case he will be blamed for the looting and the flames. He feels embarrassed. He worries that he will be looked at differently. He wishes he wasn't black. He is angry at his white mother for meeting his Nigerian father. He is so close to being white. But now he senses he'll be associated with the rioters, the muggers. He wishes he was something else, something different, not black. Moment four. He has been walking for 30 minutes, but is still only halfway there. He is 11. He likes to visit his grandparents in the leafy suburbs of Sycup in North Kent, leaving behind the concrete of Thamesmead in South London. In Sycup, there are tree-lined roads, semi-detached houses, parked with streams, and importantly, sweets and Coca-Cola provided by his gran. His mum doesn't understand why he walks to his grandmother's house so often for nearly an hour, only to be driven home in the evenings by his uncles. He is not ashamed of coming from Thamesmead, but Sycup feels safer. It reminds him of his younger childhood, a safer space. Thamesmead is where Stanley Kubrick filmed his dystopic tale, A Clockwork Orange. But Thamesmead is not a science fiction imagining. It is his cold, grey, concrete home. It is time to return home. His uncles are not around to drive him back, so his gran gives him some money so he can catch the bus back home that goes near a place called Eltham. He's waiting at the bus stop. Three slightly older white boys look in his direction. "What's the coon doing here?" "Yes, Sambo, why are you here?" He pretends not to hear. He is worried that he might get attacked. His pulse quickens. He decides to walk away to avoid any confrontation. "Yeah, that's right, nigger, walk away." He misses his bus. He gets home late. He feels traumatized, but he does not tell anyone. He decides to avoid catching the bus that goes that way in the future. Hyper aware of his own body, he will move through the white spaces of Kentish London differently from now on. Moment five. He is a university student at Loughborough University, not far from Birmingham. He still wants to become a professional football player, but he knows deep down that's not going to happen now. He will not play for Liverpool after all. Instead, he is playing for his university team. It is in the early evening on the streets of Oxford. He and his teammate, a fellow working class student from the south, are wandering along Broad Street, the very same street, no doubt, that a Jamaican Rhodes Scholar in the 1950s may have been walking down. The post-match drink is at Balliol College. A youngest man approaches with a full, overconfident stride. He has a long and ugly coloured scarf wrapped around his neck, flowing behind him. Excuse us, mate, any idea where Balliol is? The man with the scarf stops mid-stride and gives directions and asks why they want to go to Balliol. He explains that they're looking for a post-match party, having played Oxford earlier in the day at football. The student with the scarf asks, who won? We did. With the arrogance that only an English private school education finished with an Oxford degree can produce, he replies, well, that's about right. You guys are good at winning football matches. We're good at running governments. With that, he continues on his path down the street and most likely into the current Conservative government. Moment six. He is 19 and in his second year at university. The tutor recognizes the intellectual promise in the student that the student does not yet see in himself. So, what are you interested in? The student begins his list. Playing football, going for curry, R&B, a bit of SWV, soul to soul, arrested development. No. The tutor cuts him off. What are your academic interests? The student feels embarrassed. Oh, he thinks for a moment. Then he lists his areas. Sociology, politics, racism, class, popular culture, youth culture, identity, feminism, colonialism, Marxism, theory. Then he pauses and adds to the growing list, and how to get rid of the Tories. The tutor smiles. He asks if the student has read any of the work of Stuart Hall. He hasn't. The student inquires which of those topics on the list this Hall fella has written on. All of them, comes the reply. The student laughs, then quickly realizes that his tutor isn't joking. The tutor hands the student two books. Have a look at these and return them to me once you're done. The student reads the titles: Resistance Through Rituals, Youth Subcultures in Post-War Britain, and the second, Police in the Crisis, Mugging the State and Law and Order. Oh, and you'll probably want to read this one too. The student takes a third book and scans the title. The Empire Strikes Back, Race and Racism in 70s Britain. The cover image discomforts the student. Back in his dorm, he reads the following. Quote, policing the blacks threatened to mesh with the problem of policing the poor and policing the unemployed. All three were concentrated in precisely the same urban areas, a fact which, of course, provided that element of geographical homogeneity which facilitates the germination of militant consciousness. The ongoing problem of policing the blacks had become, for all practical purposes, synonymous with the problem of policing the crisis. And he understood. Later, he will speak to his mum on the phone. She asks if he's heard the news. A young man called Stephen Lawrence has been stabbed to death at a bus stop in Eltham, having missed the last bus home, heading back to Thamesmead. They think it was another racist attack in the area. And he understood. Moment seven. He is studying for a PhD. He's 24, and he's given his first ever academic presentation at the British Sociological Association's annual conference. He is nervous. He walks by a room and sees a man sitting by himself, quietly making a few notes on a piece of paper. He immediately recognizes the man. It is Stuart Hall. He is surprised that Hall is alone. Surely he should have people around him, talking to him, asking for his autograph, or bodyguards, or something. He stands outside the room, trying to work out what to do. He wants to go in and introduce himself. He wants to tell Hall how much his work has meant to him, that through Hall's ideas and words, he's been able to make sense of his own life and the world around him, that without Hall's work, he would never have found a space within the academy. He wonders about asking Hall if he'll write the preface to his book once it's finished. After all, he wrote a preface to a book by John Hargreaves called Sport, Power and Culture. His book will be better than Hargreaves, a book that doesn't engage with race sufficiently. And for one, it'll also have race and politics in the title. He thinks Hall would approve. No, that will be terrible, he thinks himself. Everybody probably asks Hall to do this or that for them. He doesn't even know me. Why would he do this for me? The young student wisely decides instead simply to introduce himself and to wish him all the best with his presidential address that Hall is about to give. He looks in again. Hall is still jotting down notes on a scrap of paper. After a few more seconds, the student plucks up the courage, takes a few steps towards the door, then loses his nerve, turns around, and walks away without ever speaking to Hall. Moment 8. He feels like he'll have to do something, but he is not quite sure what. It is 1999, he is now in his late 20s, and has a job as a lecturer at the University of Brighton. For the second time in as many minutes, the man sitting to his left has heckled Stuart Hall. Hall has given a lecture to a packed audience at the Institute of Education in central London. The talk focuses on the changes to British identity, spanning Windrush to the Scarman Report, into the Brixton riots, and into the inquiry into Stephen Lawrence's death. Hall makes a point about British colonialism and the subsequent post-war migration from the colonies. "We are here because you were there," he says. On hearing this, the man interjects, shouting, "Two wrongs don't make a right. The British working class will never ask if they wanted the immigrants." There are a few ineffective looks in his direction, but it is clear that the man intends to shout down Hall and interrupt the talk. So he decides to intervene. He has to. He looks around to confirm that the man is by himself. The heckler is middle-aged and broad-shouldered. He decides to switch vernacular codes, to draw upon his South London habitus. "Coming from Thamesmead must be useful for something, right?" He walks along the row of chairs and sits behind the man. He leans forward and wraps his arms around the man's shoulders and quietly whispers into his ear, "Listen, this isn't a public debate, it's a lecture. We've come to listen to Stuart give his talk, and you're going to shut the fuck up." The man is startled and shouts out, "I'm being accosted." "No, you're not. If you have a question, you can ask at the end, but you're going to shut the fuck up now because we've all come to listen to the lecture. Got that?" The heckler goes quiet. The boy from Thamesmead returns to his seat, his heart pounding. He sits listening to the rest of Hall's talk. He feels almost unclean from having got so close to this man. His intervention proves successful. The man remains quiet for the rest of the lecture. Yet despite the success, he feels oddly unnerved. After the talk, his friend Gary Winnell, the son of Paddy Winnell, comes up to him and thanks him for intervening and confronting the heckler. He adds, "You do know who that was, don't you?" "No, that was Martin Webster, the former leader of the National Front." Moment 9. It is February 2014. He goes through his morning routine, he turns on his computer, and he reads an email from a friend in South Africa. That can't be true. Maybe the news is wrong. He has another email from England, another from Chicago. They all have the same depressing message. He feels sick. He starts to cry. He has never cried before at the passing of a public figure. The email tells him Stuart Hall's passed away. A friend who runs a blog asks him if he can write a short memorial. He declines. Now isn't the time, he thinks. Not now. His friend asks again, so he decides to write something. For once, the words flow. He writes, "But for Hall, I would never have become an academic. There was no space for someone like me before Hall. Discovering the field of cultural studies as an undergraduate, I found validation and recognition. Suddenly, my background and way of life as a working-class black kid mattered or was important beyond the confines of South London. Most intellectuals are known for contributing on a particular topic or on a specific theme. Hall was different. He created an entire academic discipline and then mentored it just about every significant scholar that came through cultural studies in the 1970s and 80s. Hall did not give me my voice, but he created the conditions under which it was possible for me to speak, to be heard, and to do so with an advanced and enriched conceptual vocabulary. He made it possible for at least two generations of black British scholars to see ourselves as thinkers and not mere objects of sociological curiosity. In so doing, Hall forever transformed white academia and intellectual life in Britain and elsewhere." Moment 10. He opens his work email. There was an invitation to speak at a conference on Stuart Hall. He isn't sure whether or not to accept. Until now, he has declined such invitations. He searches for an email that he had got a few years earlier, a correspondence he'd almost forgotten about. He finds the email written in response to an essay that he had published on black British intellectuals and the formation of Black British cultural studies. He reads it. It says, "Dear Ben, thanks very much for sending me the essay. It is fascinating. I saved it to read in a more leisurely moment, but wanted to acknowledge its receipt at once. I'll try to send you a more informed comment once I've done so. You are quite right to speak, of course, about my ambivalence. I've written and I'm writing again about this and how it was resolved. I only wanted to say that it was principally an ambivalence about what it meant to be a Jamaican, since in my youth and childhood, the way I was brought up was to feel some ambivalence about my relationship to my own culture. And of course, nobody I knew ever referred to themselves or others, Jamaicans, as black. The sight of black migrants steaming out of Paddington Station and the thought that most of us could never go home, as we were constantly asked, in a literal sense again, and could never return to the same place that we had left, was transformatory. Most of what I've written about identity since began with this recognition. How I came to terms with my own identity is another story, but as I said then, it had to do with the strange fact that migrant communities cannot remain fixed in an old relationship to the past. They and I, as I predicted, have been remade by the migrant experience. Lamin says our generation became West Indian in London, and I became West Indian and a black intellectual in the diaspora. I'm sorry I can't write at great length, but I'm making a very slow recovery from a kidney transplant operation, which has left me very weak and energyless. Best, Stuart Hall." He finishes reading the email with tears in his eyes. From beyond the boundary of his life, Hall has provided him with an idea that he can work with, think with, and the courage to speak. A way to make sense of his own biographical journey, the moments of personal crisis and public rupture that can only be understood through a radical contextualization. He recalls a line from a previous Hall essay. "Identity, quote, identity is formed at the unstable point where the unspeakable stories of subjectivity meet the narratives of history of a culture." He begins to ponder his own unspeakable stories that he denied to himself, let alone to others, and a constant dialectical struggle between the psychological and the political, the autobiographical and the historical. The professor picks up a favorite photo that he has near his desk and sees a younger version of himself dressed in a red and white striped shirt, looking so innocent, so happy. He remembers how the boy felt just a while after when he was caught up in the Battle of Lewisham, as the press dubbed it at the time. He wishes he could reach back through time and tell that terrified and confused boy looking out of the window that everything would be okay, that his mother loved him, that his voice one day would matter, that he'll be able to make sense of the new times into which he was born. He reflects too that he would also listen to that young boy and not just speak to him. What could he learn from the boy in a photo? He looks at the last photo taken with his mother, the version he likes to recall just before her cancer took hold. He imagines the pride she must have had in him at that moment. Within 8 months of the photograph being taken, she would be dead, aged 49. He wishes he could give her a copy of his book to have seen the light, to see her face light up, but he didn't finish it in time. He dedicates the book to her. "For my mother, who made everything possible, Claire Ann Carrington, 1955 to 2005. Hall didn't write the preface, but better than that, Hall is on the inside, on every page, in every conceptual turn, in the interpretive frame, asking questions, pushing him to think at the limit. And of course, the book's cover has some red on it. The boy would be happy. He accepts the invitation. Thank you.
Deep and sincere thanks to the organizers of this conference, especially to my colleague Tina Kempt for her kind invitation and for settling me on this last panel between Ben and Barner. It's such an honor. Also, and especially to Catherine Hall for her generous grace and courage to listen while her heart is broken. And also to David Scott, because when you spoke yesterday so elegantly about voice and listening, you gave me rhyme and reason to say the words that I have prepared. I'm going to begin with a clarifier that is actually a nod to Gilbert and Sullivan. It's about my slides. My slides are merely corroborative detail designed to give artistic verisimilitude to an otherwise bald and unconvincing narrative. In other words, they are my effort to displace me from this vulnerable space. About my son's imprisonment and death, I've spoken exactly never, and I still don't know why I chose this moment, except that Stuart Hall allowed me to negotiate the crisis that was and is certainly a policed crisis. I've written exactly once, or perhaps twice, maybe three times, you see, I really don't recall, because one of the costs of incarceration, of boxing the body, is the loss of memory and certitude. So when I attempted to compose the incomprehensible to explain why I think of his absence like death, an observation I discovered upon his incarceration and before his death, I was already folded into the shroud that both protects and obscures an orderly or reliable memory of things past. Sometimes I am still there. Several years into the cycles of visits and releases and returns came his attempted escape across a prison farm cotton field. Yes, it was cotton, pursued on horseback. Then came the rifle and shots. It may have been 7 or 17 shots fired into his back. This summer, I reread To Kill a Mockingbird in order to talk about what a terrible book Go Set a Watchman is. And I realized, no, that was Harper Lee's Tom Robinson that was shot 17 times, not my son. And now I don't remember how many they said it was in his back as he was running across a cotton field toward an outer edge of woods and sky where I think and pray my spirit depends on this, that he last looked at sky. I do know because there was a witness report and an SBI report and a sworn statement where that his last words were, "I can't breathe." So what of these days of summers past and falls and winters and springs and then another summer of Ferguson's and Baltimore's and Staten Island and Arlington, Texas, but an echo, "I can't breathe." I'd like to place this very particular statement of the movement we are called today to assess and to consider and theorize the ways we are motivated by a shared concern about what the disposability of racialized subjects means, as if it is a conundrum, and how we use them in our teaching and our activism, and how we, some of us, are these subjects, and how we might constructively draw on Hall's prescient analysis. That was our task. And when I read it, I said, oh, it's an obituary we are to compose. Because for me and my work in law and medical ethics and literature of death and dying, it comes back to me as the text of the occasion, as we once said in church when we are called upon to address the occasion. But when I am called, I think of that moment of pronouncing, and then I think of death, and I see the ways in which Black Lives Matter is a version of pronouncing death. I can't breathe. Come Easter, I plan to write why there were not 7 last words, there are 3. I can't breathe. I am grateful to Stuart Hall for clarifying and engaging so substantively a moral panic. Of all of the phrasing in that text on crisis and policing, it was these that made me look within rather than without, that made me realize that surrounding the mugging, the wilding, the abuses of language, that made it so very easy to justify, and I mean this in a legal sense, to adjudicate dehumanization so that criminalization is predetermined as the outcome and a process that begins with a root word, criminal as nominative, an entity the state can manipulate as well as manufacture. I was wrapped like a winding cloth into the surround. A parent, an adoptive parent, a mother, I had a son. He was mine, not the state's. Although this was not apparent in how he came to us. One tiny brown hand tugging a black plastic garbage bag, and the other holding the hand of a social worker. And then those many years later, when a black plastic garbage bag filled with the items that had been in his prison cell was returned to us, courtesy of the post office, once again the state, at the beginning and in the end was the state. In the in-between, his body and our family were left suspended. Stuart Hall wrote of mugging. Ta-Nehisi writes that there is a space between the world and me. Therein seeps our breath, our lives, our memories. Thank you, Edwige, for imagining the spaces between the stories. where there had been breath, before the I can't breathe. When I write about health disparities and ethics, specifically cultural bioethics, I write about the ways in which the slender narratives that pass for stories and much of the nonsense called narrative medicine, how taking a patient's history, for example, becomes an opportunity for story, a slender stand-in for now I know my patient. Notice how ownership is an instinct of medicine. Consider the patriarchy, paternalism, and plantation landscapes, the body being the land. I've written about the ways in which the repeated violences of bodies who suffered through the Tuskegee experiments never, almost certainly never, talked, wrote, medicalized, were randomized in any sort of trial whatsoever, the congenital syphilis that could and almost certainly did follow those bodies, women and children, because it was the men who were our subjects. But the ones left to hear them say, I can't breathe, were absented from the paradigm of how we think we understand Tuskegee today. But nevertheless, some version of Tuskegee has become the urtext of medical ethics, in part because we are so used to a certain kind of body, sexualized but syphilitic, male and brown and black and underclass, as the only subject that might not talk back. And if he did, what those physicians were interested in was their death. After all, their interest was that they wanted to, and this was found in their records, they wanted to follow these men to autopsy. That was where the information lay, not in their living, in the pieces of their flesh. Black flesh flayed, we know this history. But the ones who received the bodies after the autopsy, or the lynching, or officer-justified homicide, those who arranged the burials, who plated the fried chicken and maybe some cobbler, who gathered graveside flowers, who wore mourning clothing, they were left to recall the last words and to say their names. I am deeply grateful that Stuart Hall made so legible and so necessary the academic necessity of theorizing the panic that arguably we are just beginning to hear, not the one within the policing class, but amongst the policed. We too have moral lives. We have pivoted from the subjects at Hall and now others who focus us on the policing and that produces mass incarceration in some ways, and in my judgment, a distancing the others. This mass, like the gravitational force of a black hole, a disappearing of space and time, this to me is a more recognizable way of thinking about those I saw, including mine own, behind bars, hands and feet chained. I can never unsee or lose that sensibility. Our panic, when we hear or when we pronounce death, is the consequence left to the rest of us. When physicians are trained, one of the things they consistently do poorly are issues related to the end of life. In last year's National Academy of Sciences meeting of the Institute of Medicine's Committee on Care at the End of Life, the lone voice on the committee insisting that death does not always come gently at the end of a life well or even poorly lived, and with enough time for a physician to enter the room and hospice to minister to the patient and decisions to be made about capacity and palliation and proxies, are black and brown folk who get used to dying when we first learn to live, who learn that our bodies are always a sudden step and a slip and a slide, a street corner or a traffic stop, a prison cell or a panicked call away for help, away from our own grief-stricken moral panics as we lie dying. What else produces those words as ritual? Or the medical disparities that begin with pregnancy and that challenge black and brown girls and women from the moment of conception to childbirth and child raising that we carry throughout our lives. Which is why the black children I interviewed imagined their funerals in junior high school, considering what dresses they might wear and a casket bunting that would match. And why the rest of us have populated t-shirt businesses so that now there is a commercial category of memorial t-shirts that communities like ours recognize as normative. I wrote on black death without a caesura. I still think about the rest of the story, the telling that regards mass incarceration statistics, but that could also explain the rise in cortisol levels, leading to cardiac pathologies, high blood pressure, weight gain, diabetes, depression, and autoimmune disorders, diseases that medicine labels as having unknown etiologies, but ask a black or brown body for a story, and they will tell you how. When somebody is absent like death, the consequence is not only a perspective of a population as a new Jim Crow, massively incarcerated, or as judiciary and its appendages. My interests have been whether because of circumstance, an event, or sympathies, or intellect, or all of these, I cannot say, with the bodies left to the margins, the private bodies that become public texts, and then that compose our legal fictions, the ones left to do the hearing and say the telling, the ones who will say these are not stories to pass on, and who will mean you may not forget because we are the ones left to pronounce. One needs a teller in times like these. I never said aloud my son's last word until I heard the tape of Eric Garner saying nothing more complicated and nothing more consequential, nothing more pitiful than his repeated perhaps 11 times, "I can't breathe." When physicians pronounce death, there is a process, checking for pupillary responses, noting their positions, heart sounds, respirations, noting the time when we are past time. And I can tell you it happens most regularly for those who did not die as fugitives, but as familiar bodies. We miss some of this ritual because there is literally no time left as we lie dying. No circumstance in a cotton field, a street corner, a jail cell, a sidewalk, a streetscape. Within what imaginary is a body left for 4 hours on a pavement while a parent or grandparent or sibling discovers a haunt they cannot unsee, words they cannot unhear, or those that wait for some inevitable cultural panic to remind us of our own vulnerability to the changing same. And then there comes the abyss. Slouching to be born, I mean toted. I suggest the legacy of Stuart Hall lies not within some interpretation of how colored acts produce a particular panic, or the regulatory agencies that arise from its policing, or the public's consequential panics, but I am invested because I live within these, with those private bodies, those families, mothers, sisters, fathers, cousin, kin, who wake and sleep to the rhythms of some child saying somewhere, "I can't breathe." The social history of our moral panic cannot erase those who are not instantiated as subject, but are privately present as collateral, damaged but not inconsequential. Some of us are left to say their names, and it comes at a cost. Our attention to institutions and structures, to the incarcerated and the likely to be carceral, cannot make a critical error in erasing the sociality that composes and recomposes and ceremonializes these bodies. Earlier this year, but perhaps it was last year, early or late, I have trouble with time, I wrote an op-ed that asked for some consideration of the children we see so prominently featured in our civil disobedience and demands for equal protection. I cautioned there that we must shield the children. Their psyches may yet be tender, their spirits still vulnerable, not quite ready for battle, and not able to instantly make normative the brutality we can tragically and reasonably predict as their experience. Damages experienced perhaps as subject, perhaps as collateral. Hall argued that analysis that instantiates the problem of the authority as the site of the interrogative cannot settle this problematic with an argument of crime as ideology. Instead, crime might be considered in this moment of visual and social media cultures and the crisis of hegemony as a catastrophe of the state. We might make our academic labor recognize our subsequent panic as the critically shape-shifting phenomenon where consent exhausts itself precisely because of our failure to visualize the consequence of public bodies as other than exceptional, like the children who can bear, but who can also be the signage. Visualization as intervention is strategic. It lies in the psychic break, which in my imaginary is the place to acknowledge as the landscape where sedition might still happen. It begs the question whether the evolution of panic and policing might be more procedurally coherent than we would want. But if this is the case, understanding how cultures regulate the product might leave us better able to interrupt the commodification of bodies and lives like these. Thank you.
I'd like to thank the organizers for this provocative conference, and especially Tina Camp for inviting me to speak. It's always interesting waiting to speak when you hear the people speaking before you. It sort of changes how you feel about what you're going to do. So my mood has been changed by listening to Ben and Carla. I've sort of been moved in a particular way. I'm feeling a little subdued. But I'm hoping that I can introduce something a little different into this particular context. I'm reminded by the previous talks that the relationship between affective labor and intellectual labor is indivisible, and so it should be. In this idiom, in this context, in relation to these particular themes. And it seems to me the thing that I want to problematize right away is the difficulty of thinking about how to talk about Stuart Hall. Now, on the one hand, it seems to me that there's inevitably a gesture towards, an obligation towards, a desire to recuperate a kind of memorialization of Stuart Hall, allied to any kind of critical engagement we might have with the work. And I think that's necessary. And it's going to be a long while before we would ever even think of trying to discard that kind of gesture. But there's also another way of trying to talk about Stuart Hall, and I want to problematize this other kind of way, which offers us a choice on the one hand to talk about everything we can possibly conceive in relation to Stuart Hall without really any substantial reference to race, politics, and blackness. That's one way. And then there's another way which wants to talk about Stuart Hall by contesting the first way and making it possible to situate Stuart Hall in relation to race, blackness, and its politics. And I want to make a case for this latter way. And I want to make this case through rereading and rethinking Policing the Crisis, but also rethinking Stuart Hall. Because sometimes Stuart Hall doesn't help you to make the case that I want to make, but sometimes he does. Let me share something with you. So we all know the book, The Critical Dialogues with Stuart Hall, and there's a number of essays in that book. And there are a couple of interviews in that book. And Stuart Hall says a number of things. And if you read his interviews, and I think I've read about 80% of the interviews that I've ever seen him do, you can get most of these online, he will tell you a story about his childhood in Jamaica, and it will be a repeated story, but occasionally he'll say things that he hasn't said before, and this is one of them. So he says, and I paraphrase, "Even when I was not writing about diaspora, race, and ethnicity, I always was thinking about them." So that sort of suggests that when we read those texts where race, diaspora, ethnicity are not mentioned at all, they are. They're in there somewhere. So what I want to suggest is that we have a protocol here to be able to read Stuart Hall working through those kinds of themes even when they're not explicit in his enunciations. Policing the Crisis. This is the fifth anniversary edition. Do you have this? I waited for the price to go down. Did you? It was like $200. I waited a year, you know. And I eventually gave in at 50. So it's a curious book. There's an interview with Stuart Hall where he says that this text isn't a typical cultural studies text. And it seems to me a lot of people don't know how to place policing the crisis, or even how to talk about it. Whenever I hear people discuss policing the crisis, they tend to discuss parts 1, 2, and 3, which sort of cover the subtitle, Mugging the State and Law and Order. But there's a part 4. It's called The Politics of Mugging. And that last chapter in part 4, because part 4 is one chapter, invariably doesn't get discussed at all. In fact, policing the crisis is often signified as if that last chapter wasn't there. As if that last chapter, if you do come across it, is a supplement in that Derridean sense that we can think about. And in that last chapter, we get a detailed engagement with questions of race and blackness and politics, all of which are missing in the conventional elaborations and reflections on policing the crisis. So what if we take that protocol that I established at the start about reading Stuart Hall in those places when he wasn't even talking about these questions? And what if we read Policing the Crisis through the last chapter? Now, when I was trying to think about how to start this talk today, I found I got manna from heaven from my old sparring partner and pal, Bill Schwartz. And Bill's yesterday, when he invoked my name, unlike me, mispronouncing it, he said that, without saying what the disagreement was between us, that in Policing the Crisis, it's a step away from violence. So I want to reflect on that notion of violence, because if you look at this last chapter, what we find described in this last chapter is what Stuart Hall et al. Describe as the birth of the colony society, the formation of the ghetto colony, which emphasized defensible space in the face of public racism and official racism, where an alternative black social life could flourish. The argument continues, the black colony opened up a new range of survival strategies within the black community. It was a space of police occupation. That's violence. Racism is violence. The colonial containment, the capacity to try and survive through strategies that cultivate an alternative social life. There's no step away from violence there. You're steeped in it. So that's potentially where I'm trying to argue some of the problem is in reading Stuart Hall. What do we look at and what don't we look at? Who owns the look? And if you work through that chapter again as a way of thinking about the rest of Policing the Crisis using its supplementary force, it's something not simply incidental, it's actually inescapably important. The context in which that black colony is formed is described by the people who lived there, this is the account, as defining an English society which is racist. So this is the experience of violence. But it's also an experience and an account of the UK which is not invoked. Now, if we're thinking about Stuart Hall writing about issues when he wasn't really explicitly stating them, he enters British society at the moment when Keep Britain White is being articulated in voices which are not his. at the moment when racist attacks are becoming a public sport. This is violence. This is race as violence, working its violence on black bodies. So, let's say something provocative, if that hasn't helped. Policing the crisis. I'm going to make an argument here that policing the crisis enables us to think about Stuart Hall as a black political thinker. It's making a contribution to black political thought. And part of my making that argument is going to take the form of asking the question, in the title Policing the Crisis, what is the crisis? I mean, policing the crisis, what is the crisis? And I'm going to make the argument, or at least suggest, that the crisis is a crisis of whiteness. I'm going to make that argument. Okay. So, it's a crisis of whiteness. How might that be? Well, to open up this argument before I then try to move to applying it to some of the more contemporary developments, we need to think a double kind of history, or to put it in Stuart Hall's terms, we need to think the history of Britain in that post-war period as impaled upon a double inscription. So conventionally, we will read Policing the Crisis as an account of the post-war period, economic decline, insurgent trade unions, the counterculture, immigration, culminating in the 1970s, working out Britain's attempt to restore itself to greatness, but failing in the post-war period. But if we double our reading of that, we will notice that the post-war period is coterminous with the post-colonial period. One of the conventional accounts that you find in Policing the Crisis, and many on the left wrote in these terms, is to think about politically what was meant by the post-war period as a social form. We might call it a conjuncture later on, and they would use the term the post-war settlement. And principally, the post-war settlement was one in which welfareism, in terms of education and health and employment, would be the very thing that governments would agree upon to enable to be in place to support working people. They would not touch that. But what's interesting when you begin to read that through the post-colonial settlement that I'm going to describe, if we're thinking about the crisis when that breaks down, is that the post-colonial settlement will be one in which the non-white other, the formerly colonized, will be incorporated into our participatory democracy, but under the hegemony of an unmarked whiteness. Now, it's when that becomes questioned in its unmarkedness and in its hegemony that that underpins a crisis of whiteness. And I'm going to try and elaborate some of that argument. So, let's do this as a polyrhythm. I'm going to say something now, if we can remember that, about Ferguson. Because if we cannot use any of these theoretical protocols in other places, then what's the use of these protocols? I want to read you something. So in March 2015, the US Department of Justice published a report called Investigating the Ferguson Police Department. And I want to take this quote to illustrate this. The culture within the Ferguson Police Department influences officers' activities in all areas of policing beyond just ticketing. Officers expect and demand compliance when they lack legal authority. They are inclined to interpret the exercise of free speech rights as unlawful disobedience, innocent movements of physical threats, indications of mental or physical illness as belligerence. Police supervisors and leadership do little to ensure that officers act in accordance with law and policy and really respond meaningfully to the civilian complaints of officer misconduct. That could have been taken from the last chapter of Policing This Crisis. It describes the urban colony, the black colony. It describes violence. So the question for me is now, how might we begin to think about Ferguson as an indication of policing the crisis? The analytic that flows from there is an indication of the crisis of whiteness. So let me see if I can try and develop that through a way of narrating Ferguson. So the racial events identified with the signifier of Ferguson since August 2004 created a number of scenes in which mobilization took place in relation to that and other black police scenarios of death under the signifier Black Lives Matter. This was profoundly evidential of something that was no longer settled in the post-colonial, I'll use this term, post-civil rights to mean the same thing. That settlement, something was now being unsettled and had been unsettled for the last 60 years. The policing crisis becomes the interface of the crisis around whiteness. Why do I say that? Because if we look at the response of what I'm calling whiteness, the hegemony under which our consent to live in societies divided around race, they call that race relations, the response of whiteness meant that you began to see the profound failure of the state and mass media to deracialize and to depoliticize the killings of black people. Every single incident was treated as a single incident, which meant it couldn't be racialized, it couldn't be politicized. And that in itself offered up the relationship of antagonism out of which always emerges something that gets to be called black politics. And with those attempts to deracialize and to depoliticize, you had organized black protests confronting the deeper reactive militarization of the police and the criminalization of black protest. Now, what's interesting about that, if we relate that back to policing the crisis, for those who focus simply on the first three sections of policing the crisis, your capacity for talking about race goes no further than saying that mugging, this crime label imported from the US, which indicates street robbery associated with violence, had been resignified as a black crime. But if you read the final chapter, we begin to recognize that in addition to this resignification of mugging as a black crime, that black communities are being criminalized. It's a crime to be black and in community. And that in itself always offers up the antagonistic conditions of emergence for something that gets called black politics. So since the death of Michael Brown, the issue of policing assaults and killings of black people have been occurring and reported almost relentlessly week by week in this country. If you switch now to the UK, even before the issue of policing was being framed in the US in these terms of relentless everyday killings, in the UK, for the last 30 years, the question of black people dying in police custody has been unrelenting. Race as violence. Riots have emerged in the last 30 years several times in the UK around that question of policing and race as violence, and the protests which accompany that being criminalized and fought with extra violence. That reminds me of the article that we should use to think about policing the crisis, written by Stuart Hall in 1978, Racism and Reaction. There isn't one without the other. Those two are held in tandem. We always need to think about that. So what we find as part of the reaction, when there is this emergence of the organization of blackness taking a political form, that the response of whiteness, by which I mean rule and hegemony and the social order in terms of racial divisions, firstly includes the racial demonization of black individuals violated by the police, and the racial pathologization of black protesters in the mass media. That doesn't happen to every kind of group unless you fall on the other side of the line which marks you as non-white. And the second response has been what we might describe as racial securitization, which includes marking black politics as an impending threat. If you go back 20 or 30 years in this country, it was called terrorism. Increased policing of protesters, and militarized or community policing, state and corporate surveillance, mediated by the mass media. Now, what's been interesting in, say, the 30 years or so since Policing the Crisis was published is the emergence of black social media, the counter-hegemonic moment, trying to create these alternative ways of thinking about these brutal mass images of black bodies dying and being violated at the same time as trying to articulate an alternative sense of black sociality. So you can see an antagonism here over the representation of how we understand the society in which we live. Quotation from Stuart Hall, because we're trying to describe the idea of crisis. I always noticed with Stuart that there were certain words he used over and over and over again. He used new when it had gone out of fashion. He used seminal. That was another one. He liked that one. Everything was seminal. And he used crisis a lot. And what's interesting about crisis is that it is very closely associated with conjuncture. I was listening to people making reference to conjunctural this and conjunctural that. And someone once said conjecture and then corrected themselves to conjuncture. But the point was, it's always related to crisis. Crisis. And the important thing about crisis is that there is this impending sense that things that were held together are being pulled apart by the very contradictions that were holding things together, in a sense. So what does Stuart Hall say about crisis? Crisis of hegemony. When the whole basis of political leadership and cultural authority becomes exposed and contested, masks of liberal consent and popular consensus slip to reveal reserves of coercion on which the cohesion of state law depends. Now, it almost sounds like when I read that, I didn't mention race. But what if that was the basis upon which Stuart Hall was making that observation? This goes back to the point that Gina Dent made yesterday about black generalizability. What if he was saying that you can talk about this social world from the point of view and from the perspective of blackness, which always has implicated in it relationships to all kinds of different kinds of populations? What if that's possible? Isn't that what's happening here? I mean, after all, Policing the Crisis tells us that here was a society that began to read itself through race, trying to resolve economic crises in terms of race, policing the populations that are seen as contaminating the place. That's not a crisis of whiteness. What is? A racial crisis is a crisis of whiteness, if you hadn't worked it out. I'm just putting that together. This is occurring in relation to the sign Black Lives Matter. So because of the time, Tina keeping me on track, I shouldn't have looked over there, should I? But I can always sense you. I just want to end with my five propositions, sort of derived from where I'm going here, in order to analytically position what I've been saying. First proposition is this. Post-war settlement in Western nations is a post-colonial settlement. And what does that mean? On the one hand, you're having in the UK a kind of inviolable hegemonic welfarism. We're settled around that in the rebuilding of our societies. And in the US, it's a civil rights settlement. You know, segregation is over. African Americans have civil rights. But we need to think about this being underpinned by what I'm calling a post-colonial settlement. Now, this has various different kinds of periodizations, but one way of understanding it is to go back and read Ida B. Wells in 1898. And Ida B. Wells is writing at a time when she's looking at the establishment of Jim Crow. Now, if you think about the power of that kind of white supremacy, it is formidable. But one of the things that she notices is that many white populations are saying that this is a white man's country. Now, given that you've just established Jim Crow, why would you need to say that? And the reason that you would need to say that is because black people have participatory democracy and citizenship, but in terms of your representation of the nation, you will concede that, but in terms of the performativity of race, you will not concede that. And that's the settlement, that you participate but under white hegemony. And in each of the post-colonial phases, that's what's settled. And we're still working with that. It follows proposition two, that the Western social order is a racial order. And you can see Stuart Hall trying to grapple with this in his article, Drifting into a Law and Order Society, or where he's talking about multicultural drift in the multicultural question, or when was the post-colonial? Because in those arguments, he's saying, we need to read the metropolis and the colony as if they are an indivisible sociality. And if you do that, you begin to see where the urban colony comes from and why the city remains as a custodianship of liberty for other people. Third proposition, the crisis of whiteness is a crisis of post-colonial racial rule. And this is where I want to say something a little tricky, which is to say that part of enshrining that unmarked whiteness would continue to rule was done by enabling official discourse for the first time to challenge something called racism. And at that moment of challenging something called racism, racism was writ in terms of representational language. It was discourse, it was legal, it was locutions, and so on. What it didn't challenge, and what was allowed to continue, was the performativity of race, where governance of black populations through race was continually done through practices which were not named. The best example of that is racial profiling. You can't take racial profiling to court because nobody says anything. There's no enunciation. It's a crisis of whiteness when the performativity of race begins to be challenged, and that's what's happening when we challenge the police. And finally, I've got two, I'm gonna say this both in one sentence each. Black politics, often people are talking about blackness, is symptomatic of the contestability and the contingency of racial rule. The form that black politics takes, or blackness politicized, is to symptomize responses to and the comportment of ourselves to and the contestation of the very performativity of racial rule which is missing from representational discourse. And finally, that Stuart Hall is a black political thinker. Thank you.
Well, finally we have ample time for conversation. So I want to open up the floor for questions. I also want to open up the panel for questions to each other. If you have responses to the amazing presentations that you just made, I welcome them. So
thank you all for your insights and your perspectives, especially as a student who hasn't studied much of Stuart Hall's material. I definitely have some homework assignments that I'm going to give myself, right? But I do have a question, because earlier, before the school year started, I went to a performance of Rachel, written by Angelina Well Grimke. The New Brooklyn Theater was performing it. It was an anti-lynching play that was written in around 1916 and was again performed in 2015. Within that play, at least, as it is an anti-lynching play, there are segments of Eric Garner's repeating "I can't breathe." There's excerpts of Trayvon Martin's also identifying her son's body in the courtroom. So there's this recurring theme within that play, written 100 years ago, about looking at how we're going to protect our children, which Professor Holloway, you were speaking about in your piece. And I guess my curiosity or my concern is, how are we to protect our children when, as represented in the play and as continues to be represented today, children, and I consider myself still a young adult as well, we're always confronted with this violence of racism, right? And we don't know how to shield ourselves, and we would like to be shielded, but it's always an attack on us. So is it a possibility to be shielded, or what's your perspective on that?
I think I did thank you for that question, because that's certainly the place where I am still perplexed. But it's at least within our range of responsibilities to think about our children as vulnerable. I know with the movements about don't shoot, hands up, don't shoot, or the other version of that, which is lying, the lions lying down dead. Mm-hmm. And it's extraordinary to me, because it's an abjection I would never consider placing myself into. You will not see me at Duke Chapel holding up my hand saying don't shoot, because somebody might, you know, or lying on the floor pretending to be dead. So there are ways in which the texture of playing around with that vulnerability is certainly performative and interesting. But what it doesn't do, and I'll tell a quick story. I raised two children. During the killings of children in Atlanta, our church in Kalamazoo, Michigan, was showing solidarity, and we put black armbands around our children and marched them into the sanctuary. My daughter thought it was a fashion statement. She thought it went with her black patent leather shoes, and it was cute. And my son asked me, does this mean I'm next? So the way in which I did not allow for their individual spirits to think about them in terms of my own sort of, they must be a part of the movement, is something I still punish myself over today. So in shielding, I just want us to, you know, our children are vulnerable to this kind of pathology of police actions. But if we don't also think that they might be wounded and receive this information about their vulnerability in ways that is permanently damaging, or damaging in ways we don't like to think about, then we're not giving them the possibility of their own childhoods. And I know the history of the civil rights movement. I was there, you know, that old. And I know the way in which we use children, because they would not be arrested. But I think that there are also some psychic wounds from that moment. And if we don't allow a full humanity for black children that considers this, how can we possibly teach them only about the kind of protection from the outside world without also thinking in tangent about the protections they need? So it's not an either or, it's a both and they contradict each other very well, than I contain multitudes, Whitman.
Just as a follow-up to that, what struck me about the image that you showed of the two children with the signs was, for me, looking at it and having seen it, because it was circulating so, obviously, right, circulating so widely. And my thoughts on that were, like, twofold, which is the issue of shielding, but also the ways that, excuse me, that Black children are never allowed to be children.
Yeah.
And that, it's the image is a tricky thing, because it's obviously using the child's handprints to sort of evoke innocence of childhood, et cetera, mm-hmm. while at the same
but
time.
But they're red and bloodied.
Right, mm-hmm. right. While at the same time sort of thrusting them into this sphere, which is an adult sphere, it right, is. Of activism, and the ways that well-intentioned act sort of also sort of denies them the childhood. But also, I was thinking about the ways that this form of activism is so much geared at the viral, that it's not actually about those two children. It's about those two, as you said, they're bearing the sign, and they mm-hmm. are the sign. And this way in which, I don't even know if this is an actual question, so I apologize for that. But the ways that rubric of it being about the image that circulates also is a step further from their actual humanity, where I don't know who those kids are,
right?
Right? But I know how that image functions. And mm-hmm. I just wanted to throw that out there to think about, especially as we talk about like Black Twitter and Black Lives Matter and hashtags and the digital, the ways that move towards the sort of viral like form of activism mm-hmm. can on the one hand be a form of validating Black lives, but also a way of a further abstraction away from sort of actual Black humanity.
So. I think that's right. I'm also thinking privacies here, because in our not being able to think of a Black child's body as a private body, but as signage, we dispossess them of something that we think of as a basic fundamental human right.
I actually wanted to add on to that I felt like there was a really productive tension between your presentation and Ben's presentation, because you're ending on the children, and Ben starting from the perspective of the child was something that was incredibly powerful to me, is that you were actually talking about the consequences of that moment of perception and embodiment. And so I was really struck by the various moments that you were talking about, Ben, of recognition and bewilderment, right, that don't stop, that there's a kind of spiraling of the way in which the adult comes to look back at the child and speak through the impressions that were made on the child in those particular historical moments. And I just thought there's a conversation to be had there.
Yeah, I don't know if there's anything I would... I mean, part of that last line that I included was partly inspired by David's talk yesterday, which wasn't simply about what can we tell the child. I mean, that's the... You know, looking back into the photograph, you know, what could I say to the boy then that I know now, which is a fairly obvious trope. But trying to reverse that, actually, to say what is lost and what type of psychic harms are done to us that we cover up, that we get used to because we have to live, and trying to reclaim something, you know, and to reverse it, to say actually what can the young boy say back to us in this moment. Yeah. And but part of it also, I was wondering, Carl, if you could say a bit more about the practicalities and the possibilities and even the politics of trying to protect children. So the urge is obvious, yes? I mean, that almost goes without saying. But how does that protection manifest itself? And especially if we're thinking about the multifaceted nature of contemporary forms of racism, anti-Black racism, we can understand how the types of violence that are getting acted by the state, by the police, you can hold yourself in a particular way, you don't go to certain spaces, but what about that cutting remark that comes from the seven-year-old when you're waiting at the bus stop? What about that moment in the classroom when the teacher reads you in a particular way? Because parents cannot be there the whole time, so it actually becomes an impossible
project, so.
You know, I have, it is an impossible project, and I've thought about it this ridiculously, which is why I only teach law instead of practice it, that all legislation that should, that could address bettering children should have like an asterisk on it and go immediately through the House and then to the Senate and then to the President's desk. Something that we, because, and I'm acknowledging here that protecting children is not something that we can do within the privacy of our own households, that it is not just a community act, it's a state act, and yet our state structures are so structured towards politics and against that kind of protection. When we see the images of immigrant children, refugee children right now in Europe, I keep thinking, what are they going to think 10 years past? What are they going to remember from being thrust through the window of a train or being in that refugee camp, how many years later? So I wish that, and so I'm only at wistful, I wish that our policies, our, both our global and state policies, were more specifically addressed to, on some occasions, just do it because we have children we need to save. But because they are not, I'm left with just remembering that there are some things that touch children differently. And so children who grew up and managed their way out of a refugee camp might need a different kind of assistance as they are older than a child who grows up in a home where, who doesn't have that kind of disruption. And to understand that as a disruption, not that these are super children who are vulnerable, who are able to withstand this kind of abuse. This has something to do with the way we think about black and brown bodies being able to bear a certain kind of pain. And there's actually a medical history that suggests that we can bear more pain. Well, our children can't. And we earn the wounded psyche. We inherit the wounded psyches that we create. So I'm left with mindfulness, which is a pitiful strategy. But it's better than deciding children are part of this same company of a public representation rather than a private potential of a private tragedy.
So I just want to follow up, and this is a very much an opening. I was provoked, Carla Holloway, by what you just said, because I'm both very inspired by your speaking of the children this way. And at the same time, you led then to thinking about protection and spoke about the law and our current legal system as a space of protection. And it made me really want to think in this context and thinking about Hall and about thinking about the policing the crisis of how we should be thinking about the state, the notion of protection, and our relationship to our legal system. Because I think one thing about this particular moment, the moment of the black president, the moment when we have to come to terms, not so much with the forms of representation which have to do with which kinds of bodies can be in which kinds of jobs, but rather the very nature of our state, I think is forcing us to grapple with different kinds of questions in politics. And I just think that having read the materials that we've all been thinking about for this conference, it makes me want to ask you all how you think about that.
I think that goes to the political science side of this. So I wonder what Bernard.
What's the question?
The question is can we think of the law as a space of protection? Can we, what definition of the state should we have? Can we rely on the way mainstream political science has characterized the definition of the state? Should we, following Stuart Hall and others, narrow how we articulate what the state is? I don't want to answer it for you. I mean, I'd rather have you say it.
Yeah, I think you have answered it. You know the answers to those questions, so let me just repeat what you already know. See, the traditional difficulty is whether we buy the narrative that we were told in terms of the post-colonial end of empire narrative and the post-civil rights bit black people were fully accredited citizens in the US. If we buy both those narratives, then the state and law as its representative can protect all of us. But if we don't buy those narratives, if those narratives are actually legal fictions, yeah, then we have to have a deeper analysis of the state. And I think this is what's going on in policing the crisis, because for me, when we're thinking about state formations in Europe or in the US, traditionally those state formations operate on the level of presupposing who is the citizen to which these laws apply. And I find even Michel Foucault does this when he's talking about biopolitics, when he talks about the construction of populations. These are not black populations. Black populations are not part of the construction of populations over which and in relation to which the rules and the accountability of rules apply. So if the state that was once the metropole and the colony is actually operating in these mainstream metropolitan spaces, then we have to think very, very differently. On the one hand, you have, if you're looking at the whole history of, say, liberty under liberalism, even if you look at political thinkers that are revered by political theory, whether it's a John Locke or whether it's a John Stuart Mill, when they're thinking about liberty, they're always thinking about liberty in relation to the already accredited citizen. And they will be very clear that they're not thinking about the slave or the colonized. That's the tradition of liberalism. It's not freedom for those who are not already free. They're worried about losing freedom because they're already free. If we think about the way in which democracy intersects with liberalism in Western nations, we know that it was always, even if we follow, and I say this with a nod to my Canadian friends, C.B. McPherson's work on possessive individualism and the way in which democracy was an intersection with liberalism, it didn't sort of flow out from it freely, it had to be fought. But even those institutions of democracy operated racially. So there's always been that presupposition that the citizen is white, yes, white and male and straight, but if you can get in a line where you've got some affinity with whiteness, you're not outside of that. So do we think in those terms? Now, if we don't think in those terms, then we will think that people like 12-year-old Tamir Rice can be protected. It's 12 years old.
Yeah, I agree with you as if I were answering from a space of political theory. But from a place of pragmatism, I know exactly where this is going to go in the courts. I know precisely how important it's going to be to elect judges that are going to be more empathetic to the humane, to the humanity of a Tamir Rice than a judge who will not be. I think being able to elect a president who uses his signing power statements to reduce the kinds of criminal criminal consequences to people with nonviolent criminal drug offenses is important. So I have this war in me between that humanities English professor who thinks exactly in those ways and the pragmatism of, and how am I going to get something changed right now? It means I'm going to make sure people are registered to vote and vote a lot in a way that knows that the Supreme Court is in a very tenuous situation right now in terms of the count for the justices whom I would support and those whom I would not. And I've got to vote in the presidential election because of that. So there is that push and pull, and it might be because I'm a woman of a certain age who needs a fan, but with that person who was far more interested in engaging that that theoretical space of how we are considered as humans to the way in which the law has structured us into a particular kind of conduct where if we want a solution, we better figure out how to get it legally.
No, I agree with all of that.
Okay.
I think our problem has been, and this is why I talk about the post-colonial settlement, is that those strategies, and we need those strategies,
and we are those strategies, have to take place within certain parameters. Mm-hmm. And we still navigate our place under a particular kind of white hegemony. Now, you can get and make certain kinds of successes. And even though we've moved in many ways from, you know, white supremacist societies to white privileged societies, we're still positioned to try and assimilate ourselves to some of the benefits of white privilege. Hence, we have a black president. So I agree with you. All I'm saying is that they are the parameters within which we're operating for our success.
So another question here.
Yeah, I have a question for Barner Hess. I want to thank you for a really excellent talk and reminding us of the relationship between whiteness and decolonization, the crisis in the British state. Well, my question is, so, I mean, there's a lot going on in Britain in the 1970s that policing the crisis addresses. There's the war against the IRA in Northern Ireland. There's war against the trade unionism in the 1970s. There's war against subcultures. There's the rise of feminism. There's a kind of war against women that's going on in policing the crisis that's consolidated within the British state. There's the rise of Scottish nationalism. And many of these things, to my mind, which are related to whiteness, are also related to Englishness. And so, which is, I'm wondering if you think it's the same thing and whether one can be reduced to the other.
Well, I was born in the UK, and one of the things I recognized very early on was that Englishness was always inflected through whiteness. And even at the point at which those of us who were non-white were invited into Englishness, it was still under the custodianship of whiteness. So there are various kinds of whiteness in the world.
Some of English, some are American, some are Canadian. And I think it's very important to look at that because all we then have when we're talking about Englishness in relation to whiteness is the specificity of its colonial trajectory. What was its relationship to its non-whites? At what point do they find themselves being invited into or participating in the democracy? How do they get policed? Where do they live? All of these are ways in which the notion of a second-class citizenship for those who are non-white becomes the notion of a second-class Englishness. And for me, they're not separate. They are imbricated.
Barner, I'm wondering if you'll be willing to go a little, you ended your fifth proposition that Stuart Hall is a black political thinker. And I'm wondering if you can say a little bit more about what you think is at stake in making such a proposition. And a black political thinker seems to leave open that he's read another way. So what's that position against, if you can say something more about that?
Okay, I think I sort of said that at the start, and I said part of the problem is, and I know what you've done here, and I will do what you want me to do, is to, you know, and I've grown up with this. And Stuart Hall, traditionally, when I grew up in the UK, I heard references to Stuart Hall. You went to university, heard references to Stuart Hall. I did not know Stuart Hall was black. When I was watching What the Papers Say one night and I saw Stuart Hall on TV, I fell out my chair. How is this possible? And I'd been in situations where Stuart Hall's name is invoked, academic circles, and no one made reference to the fact that he was black. No one made reference to the fact that he was Jamaican. No one made reference to race. How is this possible? Let me go one further. I've been in conferences where people have spoken about Stuart Hall and not mentioned that he was black and not mentioned race in any substantial way. I've heard elements of that at this conference, if I'm being honest, for you here. So I think what's at stake is that, you know, part of the difficulty for those of us still who work out of Britain is that it's very hard to invoke race or blackness in certain circles. So we speak like ventriloquists. We try to insinuate it here. We try to expand the metaphor somewhere else. I've always speculated, what was that like for Stuart Hall in the 1950s? or the 1960s, when seemingly there's no community of black scholars around? How does he have that persuasive voice? So what's at stake is actually trying to recuperate as legitimate politics where blackness is getting politicized, rather than seeing it as something that has to wait before the left to get itself together and then you get administered to the categories of the left. There actually is a black radical tradition. So you will see in Stuart Hall's work a sort of double bind. On the one hand, he does this other work with Marxism Today, and he's the only one on the left talking about the police. So whenever he talks about the police, he's talking about blackness. And then somewhere else where it's not being published by Marxism Today or New Left Review, he's doing all this stuff on race and diaspora and ethnicity and race, some of which gets disowned by and never referenced by the people on the New Left or the people who did Marxism Today. So what's at stake is expanding our notion of politics as well as our notion of the kinds of sociality which are taking place through these various forms of drift. You know, coming out of these migrations and coming out of the deepening social engagement of the generations that name themselves as black.
I need to thank everybody who has attended over the last 2.5 days. I need to thank our panelists in particular for amazing presentations. And it's a very overwhelming task to sort of end this convening of minds. But on behalf of all the organizers, we thank you very, very much for the conversation and the discussion. Thanks.